Welcome to Reality Creative Video. I'm Hermes, and this is part one of start to finish platinum, the smoky or clear version of it. Now, I'm going to be cutting this into a couple, two parts, because I need to show you first what you need in order to make platinum, and perhaps a little bit on why you need these certain things, equipment and stuff, and what you need. And then in part two, we will cover the actual putting in the chemicals and the amounts and things like that. So platinum is a tricky process. It requires a special environment in order to work properly. Needless to say, if someone tells you they have a simple and easy way of making platinum, well, I wouldn't believe them. Let's tell you that. Because platinum is very tricky. If you don't have everything the way it's supposed to be, it's just not going to work. And I've been working on this formula for a long time. Now, this is not a perfect formula. I would like to take the time and wither this formula down into what I call a perfected state. But that'll take a while. And I know there are you guys that are waiting or chomping at the bit in order to get your hands on platinum. And so, this process is going to give you platinum clear, or what I call light smoky platinum. Can't actually see it here. I'll show you some pictures of what the light smoky platinum looks like over here. And the thing is, it can only cook so far. This is the limitation of this formula. Something happens in the liquid, two things happen in the liquid actually, that prevent you from cooking it past the point of what I call, you can easily cook this anywhere from 3 to 8 parts per million, and if you're really lucky, you might get it to 10 parts per million. The reducing agent that we're using is going to be, is limiting the amount of platinum that we can strip off it. But still, it's impressive because there really isn't another formula for platinum by electrolysis out there. So this in itself is a breakthrough. And as I've explained in other videos that I've done on platinum, if you've watched the previous videos on platinum, in fact, maybe I should make a playlist, lump them all together. I don't think you need a lot of platinum. I've been using, this is the first stuff I made, which is the caramel colored platinum. It's about 1 parts per million. I may have a video on how to make that down the road, but for now, we're going with the clear smoky because that is consistent and it works well. So what I'm saying is I've been taking that 1 parts per million stuff, and it's absolutely floored me with the effect that it's having on me. It's an anti-inflammatory. It's like unbelievable anti-inflammatory and a pain reliever. I just can't believe how much, you know, it relieves in pain. It's increased my intuition tremendously. I think it's a wonderful colloidal to hook up with ruby red colloidal gold. Taking the platinum and the gold, I think it's terrific. If you've seen my video on my Christmas short on the three wise men, silver, gold, and platinum, I mean, you take these three, I think, all the colloidals that are out there or that I make and stuff, if you want to take these three colloidals, I think you're set, man. You're pretty much set. But anyway, I'm kind of getting away from the story and just adding extra time to this video. So, all right, so we're going to be making the light, smoky, or clear version of platinum, which is you're going to be able to cook anywhere from 1 to 8 parts per million. I'm going to say my goal in this one is anywhere between 5 and 6 parts per million for this particular trial. Now, the problem with cooking it longer is a couple things happen here. The solution becomes saturated, and we're not sure why, and no more platinum will go into the solution. Something that you need to investigate. The other thing that happens is you get platinum dioxide on the cathode. And once the platinum dioxide starts forming on the cathode, that also locks up the process. And the only way to get that that platinum dioxide off of the rod that I have found so far, I mean, you don't want to use sandpaper on platinum, not to mention the fact that you'd have no platinum left after a while, very soon, shortly, because I'm using 24-gauge platinum rods. They're kind of small. And believe me, you sand those down, you're not going to have anything going on. So the only way I've gotten the platinum dioxide off is that when you put it in the next process to cook it, the platinum dioxide is burned off in the very beginning part of the process. So the more platinum dioxide you have on there, the less platinum you're going to get off in the process down the road, because the platinum's not going to come off until the platinum dioxide is off. And then the platinum comes off, and then you start getting solution in there. So if you have a heavily cratered piece of platinum full of platinum dioxide, which is a brownish, reddish color on the platinum, you might be wasting valuable time in the solution to get platinum. No. Anyway, you're going to need some specialized equipment. First, you need a power supply capable of locking the current. This is a 0 to 60 volt power supply, and this is what I would recommend. I don't know if a 30 volt power supply is going to work. This has a capacity of 5 amps. We're going to be locking the current. This power supply has voltage locking and current locking, and we're going to be locking the current at 1500 milliamps, 1.5 amps. And that's very important, because if you cook it at too high a current, you're going to get a platinum dioxide on there a lot faster than you should. And if you cook it underneath the amount of current, you're not going to get any platinum in the solution. So that's important. You're going to need that. You need a stirrer. Absolutely have to have a stirrer. You have to be able to agitate the fluid. Do you need heat? Heat in the beginning can help. But you're not going to specifically need heat for the whole process, because we're going to be pulling so much energy, 1500 milliamps, through this solution that it is going to actually sit between 70 and 80 degrees C, which is good because platinum will not cook unless it's over 70 degrees C. So if you're like in a place that's really, really cold, and you can't, the natural current process that's going through here does not heat this solution, this 500 milliliter solution, to above 70 degrees C, then you're going to need a heated stirrer in order to maintain at least the 70 or 80 degrees C. I'm going to be cooking this at 80 degrees C, which is pretty much what happens with 1500 milliamps and 500 milliliters of water. You can cook it hotter. I've cooked it at boiling. It may cook a little faster at boiling, but then we're talking about a 5 to 8 hour process. You're going to have to keep topping it off with fluid. So if you're boiling away the fluid, you're going to be having to put an awful lot of fluid in, or over a short period of time, to replace what's boiling off. So I try and cook it at 80 degrees C. That way the boiling is not going crazy. You're going to need a pH meter. Now you're going to need the pH meter to set the pH initially. The pH in this is going to have to be over 10. We're going to make it 10.75 pH, because that's as high as I can make it. And then after the whole process is finished, you're going to need to lower the pH down to something that's not so high. Now, the pH will naturally come down as you're cooking it, but it won't come down far enough for drinking. So you're going, at the end of the process, you're going to have to add a little malic acid to lower the pH. You can use citric acid, or you can use ascorbic acid, which is vitamin C, to lower the pH. It just might turn the solution yellow. This, I don't know if you can see the difference between these two solutions here. All right, in this solution, I use malic acid to lower the pH down to 7.2. On this solution, I use ascorbic acid to lower the pH to 7.2. And as you can see, this solution is yellowish, and this solution is clear. So know that if you use ascorbic acid or citric acid, you're going to get a light yellow tint to your colloidal platinum. So I like mine clear, and I think malic acid has some good health properties. So I use malic acid. Whether you what acid you want to use to lower the pH is up to you, but that just brings our ingredients up a little bit more. What are the main ingredients that you're going to need? Okay, are you ready for this? Now in the future, I might have a streamlined process here that uses less ingredients. Right now, I'm using more ingredients than we probably need, only because each of these ingredients help to alleviate the platinum off of the rod and stabilize it. All right, so you're going to need washing soda. Now, washing soda and baking soda are not the same thing, but you can make baking soda from washing soda. So I want you to make sure you watch the video on how to make washing soda from baking soda. We need the high pH of washing soda. Baking soda is only going to get us to 8.5. Washing soda will get us to 10.75. So that's the first player that you're actually going to need. You're going to need vanilla. This is vanilla extract. Well, vanilla flavoring or vanilla extract. There's alcohol in flavoring and extract, and it's uncertain. The alcohol is another agent that helps react with the platinum to break it down. I've cooked it without the vanilla, the alcohol and the vanilla, and it's worked, but not as efficiently. So it's up to you. If you don't like vanilla, you can use any kind of flavoring you want, or if you don't want to use flavoring at all, you can call out. You just may get a lower parts per million solution. Corn syrup, which we use in our gold formula and for a stabilizer. Manuka honey is going to be our reducing agent. That's going to help to strip the platinum off. Now, I use Manuka honey, but regular honey works too. Manuka honey works a little bit better because of the couple extra enzymes in here that are able to help the platinum come off a little easier. Whether you use Manuka honey or regular honey, that is up to you. You're going to need my stock solution of NaCl and sodium citrate. You review the video on how to make these stock solutions before you get ready. You're going to need these stock solutions in order to make the solution. You're going to need a copper rod. This is a copper rod, slightly coated with platinum. And that's going to be your anode. This is a 12-gauge copper rod. Any 12-gauge copper rod will work. You can't use carbon, because the carbon can't take the high current. It burns up. So don't use carbon. I would suggest that you don't use platinum either, because the platinum as an anode reduces the efficiency. Platinum has a high molecular resistance. And if you use a platinum anode, it's going to be less efficient. Which is good for you guys who can't afford platinum. You only need one piece of platinum. You just need a platinum cathode. And this is a 24-gauge platinum cathode. I have a fan here that I made to help expunge the heat building up in here. I will add this schematic for the this fan, the 40-millimeter fan thing, in the STL files that I have on the website. If you want to 3D print this up and have a fan using this top to help expunge the heat off of it if you need it. One other note about weighing the rods. I have a 3-digit scale. You guys have a 3-digit scale. you're going to notice some peculiarity with weighing the rods. Besides the fact that the material coming off is extremely light, you may be challenging to get an accurate weight on the three-digit scale. But what you're going to find, though, is as you're cooking the solution, if you keep weighing the rods, you're going to find the weight is coming down, and then it's going to start to go back up. When it starts to go back up, it's because the platinum dioxide has started to form on the cathode. And when that happens, for some reason, the platinum dioxide is actually heavier. It's picking up, my chemist and I are theorizing it's picking up elements from the solution and binding it with the platinum dioxide and actually making the rods heavier. So if you see some weirdness going on like that, where the rods actually start getting heavier, that means you're starting the platinum dioxide process. Now, this picture here is what we're going for. This is probably a 6 to 8 parts per million platinum solution. Platinum is really dense. And the best I can theorize, I mean, if I was going to say, looking at this solution, that looks like a 20 parts per million solution of any other kind of colloidal. The platinum particle size is much smaller than the particle size of other colloidals like silver. I put it at like a quarter of the size, particle size anyway, from silver. So it's very small and dense, takes up a lot of room. And gold, I think, has a very small particle size, too. If you look at gold in the video microscope, it looks like this. It's got that band in there where we can't really determine the size of the particles. And I think if we were able to cook platinum a little bit further, from 6 parts per million to 12 parts per million, we would see the same sort of thing going on. These little tiny particles would get so close together they would look like a giant solid wisp. So, but I'm not able to cook with this formula. You're not going to be able to cook it to 12 parts per million. So maybe down the road when I get a more efficient formula together and stuff like that, we can see that. Anyway, that's going to finish the beginning start to finish part one for you here. And the next part I'm going to have is going to cover the actual process itself of adding the chemicals and watching the thing cook. So, I'm Hermes. This is Reality Creative Video, and I will talk to you again soon.